How's it going, everybody? Welcome to General Hospital MV, my GH after show. Let's jump into it, and by it, I mean the pool at the MetroCourt, because it is officially here, and the show is utilizing it as much as humanly possible. I mean, we saw Gladys and Brando, Sasha, we saw TJ and Portia and Curtis, and we saw Chase and Dante, and even an invisible Rocco.
Rocco, buddy, no cannonballs this time, okay? Get people wet.
Nice try, Dad.
We can get into the stories that intertwined in the pool a little bit later, but right now I want to talk about Maxie. This girl is a mess. I mean, she is nervous because Austin has moved to Port Charles and is working at the hospital. She runs over to see Brooklyn at the Q House to tell her about it, and Brooklyn points out that she is going to be the one to blow the secret out of the water about Louise, and she knows that Brooklyn is right, so Maxie decides that she's going to leave Port Charles. For those of you that didn't know, Kirsten Storms actually had brain surgery and has been recovering for the last several weeks, and now the show has finally caught up to that, so Maxie will be off the show for a while, and this is why they did that story. Now, she hasn't left just yet, and I'm still trying to decide whether that's a good thing or a bad thing, because during this time, Maxie actually told her the whole truth about baby Louise and how Brooklyn was never pregnant, and that Maxie gave Louise to Brooke to raise her as her own to protect the baby from Peter, and of course, Valentine does not know that he doesn't have a child. Nina's pretty mad that they're keeping it a secret from Valentine, because she did say that Valentine would have protected that baby as if it was his own if they let him in on it, which I believe is true, honestly. Nina isn't going to tell Valentine because she knows it's not her secret to tell, and frankly, she doesn't really have room to judge right now with all the secrets she's keeping. Now, Maxie has to get her affairs in order before she leaves town, so she asks Spinelli if he could look after Georgie with Ellie while she takes James with her to Texas, and of course that's when Spinelli says that he and Ellie have broken up officially now. So Maxie decides to take both her kids with her to Texas instead, but before she leaves, she goes to Sam and asks her to look after Spinelli, which I think is really sweet. I like that she still really cares about him. There is a part of me that wonders if they're going to try to put Spinelli and Maxie back together, and I loved Spinelli and Maxie. Truly, they were my favorite couple back in 2009. They were so fun to watch. But honestly, the way that the characters are now, they've become so different to who they were back then, and you know, the things that I loved about them back then don't really exist within the characters now. So I don't know, I don't think I'm here for a Spixie reunion, but let me know if you guys are in the comments below. Speaking of Sam, she ran into Jason and Carly at the MetroCourt and had a bit of a word with them, but was surprisingly cordial. I mean, she talked to Jason first, and she said that she hadn't told Danny yet that he was engaged to Carly, and that she would leave it to him, and then she asks him why they decided to get engaged. This is where I get annoyed, because Jason was like, well, we shared a loss with the loss of Sunny, and that's why we ended up getting engaged. And I don't understand why Jason isn't just being upfront with Sam, and Britt for that matter. Like, why doesn't he just say that they are getting engaged because of a business situation? You know what I mean? You would be hurting a lot less people if you were just upfront and honest, and there's no reason why you couldn't have told Sam or Britt the truth. Just say it. Sunny's organization is under attack because they look vulnerable because there's no clear leadership in the organization, so they got engaged to put up a good front. Super easy to say. But no, he has to be a douche about it. Thankfully, I don't think Sam bought it even for a second, because she then goes up to Carly and says, I know that there has to be a good reason that you guys got engaged, so if there's anything you guys need, just let me know. And she just leaves, which is, you know, very respectful of Sam. Carly actually seemed genuinely shocked by it. But man, I'm actually so mad at Jason for not having enough respect for Sam, or Britt for that matter, to tell them the truth. I mean, Britt is so heartbroken, and you know, it just sucks to watch her being in so much pain. And of course, they have a scene where she's talking to Jax, and it's very clear that they are just a one-night stand, which I'm glad that the writers established, because I was not here for that couple, I'll be honest. I am not a fan of Jasper Jax by any means, but I had to give him props, because he runs into Jason at the hospital, and Jason gets all macho and he's like, you better not hurt Britt, and Jax claps back and he's like, I'm not the one who hurt her though. And the elevator door shut. I was like, Jax, I tip my hat to you, sir. Jason deserved that. I mean, yeah, it's still clear that Jason has feelings for Britt, and he was pissed at Carly for the lie that she told Britt last week, But, like, dude, you could have been honest as to why you guys are together. You are hurting Britt for no good reason, man. Later on in the week, Joey Novak shows up to the MetroCourt pool and tries to scare Carly by saying that they are not as secure as they think and that he is not scared of Jason Morgan. And then Brando steps in and scares Joey Novak off, and that pleases Gladys, obviously, and while Carly does not want to give Gladys what she wants, she can't exactly deny that Brando would be a good asset to their organization. Apparently, Sasha would take an issue with Brando being in the mob, though, even though he's technically been in the mob since she met him. I'm a little bit confused. This seems so, like, left field to me. I mean, when she first got pregnant, she was practically beaming with Brando, and he was working for the mob, even though he was just spying on Cyrus. He was spying on Cyrus for Sunny and Jason, and she seemed pretty excited to have him be a part of the baby's life, and then suddenly, I guess she's not anymore. She says that she wouldn't want the baby's father to have ties to the mob world, but I have to wonder, like, what were you thinking when you were with Michael then? Because you seem to want to spend the rest of your life with him, and he obviously has ties to the mob because of who his father was, so, like, I just don't get it. Why are y'all trying to ruin Sasha and Brando? Maybe Brando should just lose his memory and change his name like Sunny did. Right now, Sunny is actually in the state of New York with Lenny and Phyllis because Lenny's heart is getting worse and they go to see a specialist. It turns out that it's not so much Lenny's heart, he actually has cancer. Coincidentally, the hospital that they're in happens to be the same hospital that Anna and Valentina are at right now, because that's where the pilot that supposedly was supposed to pick up Peter currently is. And of course, they don't run into each other at all, because God forbid the show put us out of our 7 month long misery and move the story along. The only movement we've seen is that Sunny found a hat that looks like something Mike would have worn on the floor, and he has a memory of Mike's voice. And by Mike, I mean his father, not his second persona. But yeah, he didn't seem too concerned about it. He decides to call Nina instead and says that he and Phyllis and Lenny really need her to come home. Nina, of course, is still beaming from bonding with Wiley, and Will is talking about just how important she is to him, and we know it's gonna get wrecked when they realize that Nina's been hiding Sunny from everyone this whole time. Oof, what a mess. All right, let's talk about Austin. He has started his job at General Hospital, and he met Amy already. Hey Amy, good to see you. It's been so long, although I'm sure you're already gone by now and that we won't see you again till the nurse's ball in the fall. He actually meets Carly and they end up talking about all the major players of the hospital, including the Quartermain family and the Cassadines and the Corinthuses. Evidently, Austin is taking over Lucas's old position and Lucas has moved on up, probably to the attic, I'm guessing, where they put all the characters that they don't want on the show anymore, never to be seen or heard from again. Anyway, later in the week, the Quartermains are getting ready for their meeting where they're gonna decide who the new CEO is, and of course, in walks Scott Baldwin and Austin, where Austin reveals that his last name is Holt and that he is Jimmy Lee Holt's son that nobody at all saw coming whatsoever. Austin is basically there to stake claim for something that his father never could because Edward left him out of his will, and I really don't understand the story whatsoever. Supposedly, Jimmy Lee Holt, his father, has died and died like 6 months ago, and he is just there for his father's sake so that he can reclaim being a member of the Quartermain family again. Why he wants anything to do with a family that wanted nothing to do with him is beyond me. It's not like he is, you know, a poor guy. He has all these properties in Pawtuck. He is a doctor with his own private practice. Like, he's floating in money. So why all of this mess? I don't buy for a second that he just wants to be a part of the Q family. I'm not gonna lie, watching them banter back and forth with Austin kind of made me miss Tracy Quartermain. I mean, I would have loved to see her go toe-to-toe with this guy. Not that the scenes weren't entertaining, I actually really loved Olivia kind of schooling him on the Quartermain history, which she apparently has read up on. And I loved Monica later on comparing him to the mutt that screwed Annabelle, their dog. That mutt being Foster, Luke and Laura, and Lucky's dog. I am not kidding, this is a storyline that actually played out on screen in the 90s. You can look it up. They showed a full-blown dog romance with a scruffy street dog and Annabelle, this rich dog, and there were like montages of them like hanging out together and falling in love with hearts. It's so ridiculous and cringe, you guys. I'm not gonna watch it on GH Envy Reacts because quite frankly, there is actually a montage with Snoop Dogg's music in it, and you know, I don't wanna get copyrighted, but check it out for yourselves. All right, let's talk about Spencer. He is doing his best to not be seen or heard from Cameron and Joss, although that's pretty hard because Trina is their bestie and he's hanging out with her. He won't even take a selfie with Trina, and you know, Jocelyn apparently is starting to think that he's not real. I don't really know how I feel about Spencer and Trina just yet, because he's really just lying to her this whole time, so it's hard to like them. And also, they're kind of making Spencer a bit of a creep. Like, what is homeboy doing chilling in the top of a tree right now? Plus, there is the matter of Spencer stalking Ava and Nicholas and doing vile things to make them split apart. He did finally show himself to Nicholas and to Laura and to Ava. At this point, if Nicholas doesn't figure out that it's Spencer behind all this, then he is duller than I thought. Like, just use your brain, dude. Who else would have access to your home? Who else besides Ryan would want to keep you guys apart? Spencer is the answer. Okay, let's talk about Dante and Sam. They are avoiding talking about their kiss to each other. However, they do confide in Maxie and Chase separately, of course, and it was like pulling teeth for them. They won't even admit to them who they actually kissed. Honestly, I still can't really get into Dante and Sam, not just because I feel like Kelly Monaco is not really into it, but also because at some point Lulu is going to come back, and that is gonna make Dante and Sam dead in the water anyway. Speaking of characters struggling to confide in each other, TJ actually tries to get Curtis to open up about his relationship with Portia. It doesn't work. Curtis clearly wants to be in a relationship with Portia, and Portia clearly wants to be in a relationship with Curtis. However, Portia doesn't really want to be the rebound girl, and I can't blame her for that. Curtis should at least wait until the divorce goes through, honestly. But yeah, I really don't understand what the writers are doing with all their romantic pairings right now. I mean, last year they literally split every one of them up, with the exception of Molly and TJ, and Kevin and Laura, and also, I guess, Mac and Felicia, even though we never see Felicia. But everyone else was split up, and then they put these new couples together, and now they're pulling them apart. Like, I don't understand what's going on. I was really liking the pairings that they were trying to put together. Jason and Britt were surprisingly fun to watch, and then, you know, Dante and Sam, at the beginning, there was potential there. Sasha and Brando, I absolutely adored, and now they're pulling all of them apart. I don't understand it. Who do you guys want to see together on the show? I mean, who are you rooting for to get through whatever curse the writers have put every single couple on at the moment? Let me know in the comments below. Anyway, that wraps things up this week. I hope you guys enjoyed it. If you liked this video, give it a big old thumbs up, subscribe if you want to, and I will catch you guys next time. Peace out.